To learn coding, you need to pick a programming language first. Let's start with that. We have many options here, but I'll talk about the three most popular ones. If you want to pick the easiest option as a beginner, I recommend the first option, which is Python. That's because Python is very similar to writing in English. For example, if you have a list of numbers, and for each number in the list, you want to print it on the screen. Well, it's already done. Let's say you pick Python. Now you need a step-by-step roadmap to learn Python. More than 4 million programmers already know that the best path to learn Python and actually get a job is this video that I made a few months ago. In this video, I showed all the different free resources new programmers can use to learn Python. I also listed 3 common mistakes many beginners make. On top of that, I also showed a new method to learn programming which is better than watching video tutorials and getting stuck there. I will leave the link to this video and all the other resources I discussed today in the description. If you're someone who is scared of programming like I was in the beginning, or if you already tried other programming languages but failed to learn coding, Python is the right choice for you. But if you are willing to take up the challenge and want to open more opportunities for yourself in the tech industry, this second programming language might be a better option for you. And this programming language is Java. I could have easily replaced Java with C++, but I find C++ a little harder to grasp as a beginner, and Java does most things that C++ does for you. That's why I recommend Java over C++ to the beginners. Java is a more popular option than Python for backend applications in the industry, and that's why I believe that Java sets you up for better long-term success in the industry. To learn Java, I have already made a step-by-step roadmap that gives you everything you need for free. But neither Java or Python can help you make beautiful websites. For that, you need to learn web development. And that's the third option I have for you. Web development has 2 parts. Front-end development that helps you decide how a website looks and behaves, and back-end development that decides what happens on the server side when you perform an action on the website. If you don't know what all these things mean, don't worry about it. I will provide you everything you need today. For front-end development, we have 3 building blocks, and these blocks are HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. Often CSS is not enough by itself. You might need a CSS framework that will make your life easier. Same is true for JavaScript. Using a JavaScript framework or library like Angular or React is very common in the industry. And then there are technologies like Redux and Next that can further improve your websites depending on what you are building. That's all for the front end. Step-by-step process with all the free resources for everything that I just mentioned can be found in this video. This video also covers the backend part of web development. For the backend, you might want to learn a server-side language like Python or use JavaScript with the help of Node. Like in the front end, you would want a framework like Django for Python and Express for JavaScript to make your life easy. As you can see, this path is slightly longer than the other 2 paths we discussed. That's why, if you're someone who cannot stay motivated for a long period of time, or you are scared of programming, this path is not for you. But if you can persevere and develop all the skills needed to become a good web developer, this path pretty much guarantees a good job in the end. Only caveat I would like to mention here is that there is a big no-code movement going on right now. This movement enables people to develop websites without using any code. So many people believe that the future of web development is unclear. But for now, there is plenty of demand for web developers. To be fair, the future of most technologies is uncertain because the things change very fast in the tech industry. So I would not make a decision based on the fear of the future. You will anyway have to learn a lot of new technologies as your career progresses. Once you learn one technology, picking other technologies is not going to be that hard. So the big question is, which of these paths should you pick? I have provided you reasons for picking each path already. To summarize, Python path is easier than the Java path, which is easier than the web development path. And for the job opportunities, web development has more opportunities than Java, which has slightly more opportunities than Python path. What makes this choice even more difficult is that different paths require different level of math skills. I will tell you what math skills you need for each path shortly, but for now, just take my word for it. Python and Java path require similar level of math skills, whereas for web development, you might be able to survive without knowing any math. Based on these factors, different people should pick different paths. And as Socrates famously said, "I cannot teach anybody anything, I can only make them think." My goal in this video is to ask you questions and help you decide what will work for you. Software engineering is all about trade-offs. What better way to start your journey than understanding the trade-offs between different paths you can take? Personally, I believe I'm good at math and I'm okay challenging myself. So I would pick the Java path. Once you have built the basic programming skills, I'm sure you want to get paid to write code. One way to do that is to become a freelancer and go to websites like Fiverr or Upwork to find clients. By just learning basics of Python or Java, the chances of you becoming a freelancer are lower. That's because most freelancing jobs that are available would require web development or mobile development skills. The other safer option you have is to work as a software engineer for some tech company. And when you apply for a job at a tech company, they would do coding interviews to see if you have the required skills. In smaller companies, especially for web development roles, you might be able to get a job with the skills you have learned so far. In bigger companies, especially for the backend roles that you might get by learning Python or Java, they will ask you algorithmic style questions in the interviews. Many people seem to hate these interviews, but for me personally, cracking these interviews have opened so many doors. So I highly recommend preparing for these interviews. To prepare for these interviews, you need to master data structures and algorithms. Everything that you need to learn data structures and algorithms, you will find in this video that I made. I also cover three big mistakes people make when it comes to data structures and algorithms in this video. When you learn data structures and algorithm, you will come across this concept called big O of an algorithm. In simple terms, big O is nothing but how many times a piece of code runs in the worst case scenario. If what I said makes no sense to you, that's fine. What you need to know is that answering these kinds of questions requires knowledge of math. In an algorithmic style interview, after you finish coding up your solution, the interviewer usually asks you big O of your algorithm. And that's why you need to know some basic math concepts to crack these interviews. Like I mentioned earlier, in some cases, you don't even have to go through these algorithmic style interviews. These are usually web development jobs at smaller companies. For those jobs, you might not need any math, but to get most other jobs, you would need to have some basic math skills. Now it's very hard for me to cover all the math skills for you here. That's why I already made a video on 5 math skills every programmer needs. Along with that, I will also provide a link to a free good course for math in the description. Learning data structures, algorithm, and math is one thing. But cracking actual coding interviews is a totally different beast. That's because your learnings so far are purely theoretical and you have not stress tested yourself at all. In software engineering, stress testing is a process where you test your program under unfavorable conditions. A common way to stress test a service is to bombard it with a lot of artificially generated requests and see if it can withstand all that pressure. If you made it so far in the video, I believe that you have already stress tested my content. So I highly recommend that you subscribe to the channel. Jokes apart, we need to stress test you for coding interviews. For that, you will have to go through a lot of interview style problems and see if you can solve them within the interview time frame. And Leetcode is the best resource to practice these questions. I solved more than 500 Leetcode problems to get my current job at Google. But in this video I made a few months ago, I provided the absolutely essential 150 problems for you. I also shared all the strategies I used to crack jobs at Amazon and Google, so do check it out. We have covered all the hard skills you need to become a programmer, but are these hard skills enough? Reading all your comments for past 1 year, there is one thing I'm 100% certain about, and that is, most people fail to learn programming not because they are not good enough. It's because they are wasting away their life hoping to find some magic elixir that will somehow cure all their problems. Worse, many expect it to be delivered to their mouth by some YouTube guru. I hate to be the one to tell you this, but neither me nor anyone else can do it for you. You yourself will have to find that motivation inside you and build habits that help you learn programming consistently. Here are my learnings from the book Atomic Habits by James Clear that will help you do exactly that. My name is Sahil, and I'll see the transformed you in the next video.